So we are ready and kicking for the next session to start. We have almost like a TEDx kind of conversation coming up from one Agrawal to another one. This time it is Virendar Agrawal from Ramco. As you know, Ramco was a cement company at one time, moved into software, enterprise solutions, and now into cloud. So we are here to listen to Virendar to see how to stay agile. And all yours, Virendar, as you walk up to the stage.
Very good morning to all of you. Looks like a little late morning. Maybe all of you are looking for a coffee break. I have 15 minutes of time, so I'll just focus on what does it take to build an agile organization. To start with, what is the need of an agile organization, and then what steps you need to take to build an agile organization. So first, to start with, you know, we ran a small survey to see the mood of people, and the results are 77% of the people were happy here, and 9% of the people were sad, and 14% were just so-so. So that's how the mood was. So it looks like people are fairly happy at the conference and enjoyed the sessions here. This is something we do with our employees every day, and the measurement shows up on the display as you enter the company. As a person logs in, they see this survey done, and that's how we capture the mood and see the mood region-wise, country-wise, location-wise, and so on. Now we have the symbols coming up, so it's all about why we need to be agile. You have these companies, and the thinking would be you have a 10% more efficient engine, a 5% better some feature, and so on and so forth, and that's how they compete with each other, and so on, and that's how the competition goes on. But in today's world, the competition can hit you from totally unlikely place which you never expect. It can hit you from a place which has nothing to do with more efficiency, better features, better torque, 0 to 100 in 3 seconds, and so on and so forth. You can get hit by somebody like Tesla. That can take the market away from you completely in terms of fuel efficiency, in terms of speed, torque, everything else. So in today's world, the competition does not come from familiar competitive sources. It may come from totally unfamiliar places. It may come from total change in technology. So you have to be watching very carefully because you may get hit by somebody who is not even on your radar. So being agile doesn't mean only looking at your competition. Agile has to be scanning the entire environment to see what else can change and dramatically alter your or your company's life. Same thing with hotels getting hit with Airbnb or the sharing economy. And since we were with AWS, it's apt to put the names out there. Earlier, IBM would produce a better processor and a better server, and they will rule the world for a while before Sun came out with something else and they'll do something better. But the entire game completely changed right under their nose when AWS came with their cloud. We heard Amit Agrawal speak. They changed the game completely. And all the big vendors did was try to protect their turf, try to protect their legacy, try to make sure that they continue selling better quality servers or something, or and never acknowledge the advent of cloud. And we know now right now that AWS has taken complete dominance of this segment as well, and leaving the traditional vendors who were serving the infrastructure needs of companies in no position at all. I mean, the market share is so dominant that the next person shows up is Microsoft with 15% market share or something, after 60% or so of Amazon. So that's how you can get hit by somebody whom you least expect to, from a totally different segment, from a totally different way of working. And the speed at which you will get hit, you may not get time to. It's like if you see all the telecom companies globally are in doldrums. They're not making profits. Telecom revenues are declining because they got hit by a 12, 13 member team sitting, built up something called WhatsApp, which can make phone call, video calls, text messages, blah, blah, everything that your person needs to do without ever needing a telecom company. And we all know about taxi companies and Uber. And now coming to Indian IT services industry. So we have a similar story unfolding here whereby the growth rates are falling. We are into single digits. Stagnation is coming upon the industry. And we are getting hit by something, what they say, robotic process automation, or robotics in the software industry or in the process industry, or the chatbot revolution as we face is. First, the industry to be hit is BPO. Second is IT. And so the speed at which the change hits, it's very, very dramatic. And you need to be alert to what is going on and have to have a substantial portion of your company's energy devoted to what is coming next. Otherwise, you can get run over. So right from 20 years to 14 months is that amount it takes to reach $1 billion market cap. So an upstart you ignore for a while, they become so expensive you can't even acquire them. So you have to have your eyes and ear open to see what's coming next and be very, very alert to what's happening in the market, because these new competitors are coming in all shapes and forms and eating away your lunch. The industrial model was built on efficiency. How can I produce a bag of cement with less energy? How can I produce more cars with fewer number of work hours? How can I make my supply chain more efficient? And so on and so forth. And that can only give you incremental efficiency. But when you're, right now you're getting hit by total paradigm shift, which is of a proportion which can't be done by incremental efficiency. So industrial model of I will produce my goods, I will produce them in factories, which will run efficiently, command and control structure will exist, everything will work across the world, seems to be beginning to fail across segments and industry due to very rapid rate of change. And in such an environment, you must realize that you don't produce an electric bulb by incrementally improving a candle. You have to totally differently think and produce an electric bulb. So while you have to improve efficiency, you have to manufacture your phones very well or your cars very well, more efficiently, but a substantial portion of the energy has to go towards finding something totally new, totally revolutionary, totally out of this world, which can, and if requires, it eats your own existing products, then so be it. But otherwise, somebody else is going to do that to you. The conservative organization is like this, you know, structured like this. It's designed to be hierarchical, it's designed to be command and control, designed to be complying, designed to be making sure everything works well, but doesn't bring the innovation, doesn't bring the energy, doesn't bring the speed of reaction that you need in a rapidly changing world that is there. The responsive company is open. It learns and uses the network very effectively. We'll explain each of these points very quickly. What does it mean to be open? What does it mean to be? The open organization is like a group of teams coming together. Just to give an example, we realized that we were losing significant amount of business because our financials were not up to scratch in our ERP product. So we formed a team called Next Generation Financials. Brought in people, various levels of expertise, some outsiders as well, and started studying our competition all over the world and say what best features to incorporate, get about engineering it, and produce some very cool features. And that's how came the Next Generation Financials. And we did the same with the user interface. We put together a team called Chrysalis team, brought in a group of people. So teams come together, teams disband. Sometime people come in for 4 hours every day, 2 hours every day. You rope in outside expert. We engage companies, consulting companies, to compare our products with other products and give us feedback on what is missing in our product, what needs to be improved. So the teams need not necessarily be internal. Team can be external. Team can be a mix of consultants. The ideal team size is somebody doesn't need more than 2 pizza boxes for lunch. So 7 to 9 people can sit across the table, multi-faceted, multi-dimensional, ideally multinational, and has a diverse background, not necessarily all nerds and all engineers. This team has to be self-sufficient, has to be able to take their own decisions, and should be governed by a timeline, but not necessarily clearly defined roles, so that the team can be self-governing team where people can take responsibility and run with it on their own responsibility. And as Amit said earlier, it's okay to fail. If it doesn't work out, doesn't work out. It's fine. It's all right to fail. It's not necessary to always succeed because you need to keep experimenting. Like we are experimenting with Microsoft HoloLens. We really don't know what we will do with the HoloLens. But anything new, we experiment. We will figure out later what the use is. So the idea is be attractive to technology, have the innovation edge going in the company, have the desire to do something new going in the company, and that's what can make a difference. It's not necessary to know what the use will be because many things we can't see unless we try out. And diversity. As I said, all engineers won't make sense, so mix of nationalities, mix of various kind of people, and to make the team very, very productive. And team need not be in one physical location. Team can be spread across the world, like our next generation financial team has members from Australia, US, our customers, prospects, and our own team. And when you're building an agile organization, the first step can be a symbolic step. Symbolic step can be, don't have any cabins. Have offices like this, that's how our offices look like. Have offices like this, let people come together in a huddle, talk to each other, and you set the standards yourself that the CEO doesn't have a cabin, makes his own coffee, doesn't have a special parking spot, has no privileges. So you set that I'm open to, available to everybody, I'm approachable, anybody can reach across to me, and we will care more for what you contribute rather than the designation or title you carry. So that's a message to be sent very importantly. Eventually, it's all in the mind, but symbolisms are also necessary. If you're sitting in cabins which you can't see each other, it's unlikely to foster a close working environment. Then you need to empower the team with tools, which are collaboration tools. Some of the names we have given, the most popular being Slack, and now Microsoft Teams is coming up, something competing product to that. The team can work with each other, and the key is sharing information, no silos. If at all oversharing, that's fine. There's so much information in the world that the hierarchy cannot decide who is to get what information. Let people decide what they need to consume for their benefit. So let information not be controlled. I just give an example that we as a company, when I joined the company, I asked what is happening with this French customer. They said, we are waiting for them to sign an NDA, then we will send the presentation. It's been 2 months since the time the NDA has gone, customer has not responded back, or prospect has not responded back. So we said, what's so special about our presentation that it can't be sent without an NDA? No, they can copy something from it. To drive the message home, we put all our presentations on SlideShare for the whole world to see. So next time, nobody talks of an NDA because everything is there in public to see. So, you know, if you're trying to be overprotective, you're trying to be over-controlling, then you're becoming a closed organization. You'd rather be an open organization and use these tools so that everybody is informed simultaneously what's going on. How much you choose to know is up to you as your needs be. This is Microsoft, which was a Windows company. And when Satya Nadella came, what happened? The market caps has gone up by a few $100 billion. It's become a cool company again. Microsoft products run on Apple, which would have been, you know, heretical earlier. You would have never thought they would run on Oracle. And SQL Server runs on Linux. Who would have thought SQL Server would run on Linux? Because it was meant for Microsoft products will only run on Microsoft. Now, they better run. They first run on Apple, then they run on Microsoft. So that's the level of change has been brought by being open, by embracing others, by realizing that you can't conquer the whole world. And just see, the revenue from Windows possibly is just 18% Windows and Windows franchise, and how the revenue has grown since he's come on board, because he's made the company open. I mean, I don't know how many of you remember that Steve Ballmer said that Linux is cancer, openness is cancer. Two, Linux is cool, we embrace Linux, our products will run on Linux, and Microsoft is willing to be open. Just see the change in thinking. that anything which doesn't belong to our way of thinking is cancerous. To a way of thinking that we embrace everything, our products will run on every platform. That's a sea shift of being open. That's what is required in today's world. We'll also give example of one of our competition called Zero. It's a small company from New Zealand which went from zero to 700,000 customers in about 4.5 years time, and in the process end up eating everything in the accounting software world which it exists globally. I mean, the giants it has eaten in the process. It did it by being open. There are more than 500 third-party products which interface with it. Its engineer made the APIs open. It became very easy to connect with this company. Just go to developer.zero.com and you could provide an interface to this company. So that's a level at which they have gone. Another example of Zara of being agile. There's a recent story out, just like the Amazon Go story, doing the rounds that from the store in New York, from the feedback to the time the new quotes got designed and got delivered were just 25 days. It's because the people down the line are empowered. When you are building an agile organization, people are allowed to make mistakes, people are empowered, people can take quick decisions, people who are on the store are valued rather than vice president sitting in a corner office, because they would not know what the trend in a New York store is, which a person in the New York store would know. So that's the exact story of what happened, and that's how Zara turns its inventory 40% faster than the rest of the competition. And that's a sign of being agile, being responding to the trends very, very quickly. These are some other examples of how you use the outside ecosystem to build better products. Like Kaggle is used by P&G to see how the products are placed on the shelves in retail stores by asking customers to take photographs and send them, or prospects to take a photograph and send them and have a small reward for them. For all who are techies, GitHub is the source where the complete global repository of code exists, which you can copy and use and so on and so forth. Another key element is simplification. A lot of complexity in the organizations comes because we are always trying to measure, make people accountable, make everybody a profit center, and that kills out lots and lots of innovation because people are busy preparing reports, justifying their performance, non-performance, stance, and so on and so forth. Rather than then, the focus should be on how to solve a particular problem in a group of teams. Either the teams fail or they succeed. It's trying to fix individuals seems to be counterproductive, and over-measurement and over-reliance on numbers and measurement metrics is proving a bane of the recent current organizations. And the saying is that when you're too process-oriented, you let a person do only this and nothing else, then the person can only think this and nothing else. The story is the elephant is tied by a very thin rope to a small keg. It never breaks it and runs away. It can easily. Because when the elephant is a child, it's tied to the small thing. And as a child, it could not break through from that rope and that keg. And as it grows, it comes to believe that it won't be able to break. So that's where if your mind is limited to thinking small, then the smallness stays, and you're never able to break through. And the more process compliance, do this exactly this way and never think anything else and so on and so forth, breeds a group of people. It's necessary for an organization running industrial structure. But if you are in an organization in an economy fast changing, then you are massively threatened. And this is all about that you need to align to the cultural values of the company tightly, but rest of the alignment is loose. It's not a very tight alignment. So this is example of Spotify that we have there, that multiple teams can work on various ways of doing things, and then whichever way becomes more effective becomes viral and the entire company adopts it. As long as you have allegiance to the way of working of the company, as Amit Agrawal was pointing, the belief, customer obsession, if every employee has that alignment with the customer obsession, then other variances can be there. Again, the same thing. What is the problem that needs to be solved and why? And the team's job is to collaborate with each other and solve the problem. Instead of trying to fix individuals, people's finding mistake with them, finding which person to hang, and so on and so forth. What is the problem and how to solve it? And how each one of us come together to solve it? And if you are to be a real-time organization, you need to know what your customers are thinking real-time, what your employees are thinking real-time, what is going on real-time. We measure it every day, how our employees feel. It shows up as you enter the company, the mood of the organization. You can see location-wise, team-wise, project-wise, department-wise, accounts department is feeling side while this department is feeling much better, and so on and so forth. So you can, and it's a daily measurement. You can see the trends over a period of time, how a manager coming has spoiled the mood in the team, and so on and so forth. So you can change the organization on the go because this is every day, you know what's going on. And if your people don't feel like this, then they are not going to think in the shower, as Amit Agrawal said. Then they're not going to think in the shower how to make it a better place to work and how to make your customers more happier. And for you to make it think like this, they will think like this only if they are empowered. If they are not bound by small petty rules, if they are not forced to explain why did they spend 10 rupees more on this particular trip while their limit was only 5,000, how did they spend 5,010? If they are not made to feel small, they will behave big. If they're made to feel small, then they will, if they're made to live within boundaries, then they will work in their boundaries of 9 to 5. I'm supposed to do this, I'm supposed to do that. That's my charter, that's not my job, and so on and so forth. If you have boundaries for them, they have boundaries for you. So that's all from my side in terms of building an agile organization. The way we have shaped in our company is that anything that comes to me for approval is automatically approved because I can't be bothering myself with a travel claim of people who are getting paid so much money. And if I'm going to waste my time in these kind of things, then you know, either I don't trust them or they're no good. So we have tried to dismantle as much bureaucracy as a company as we can and see the effect in the field. Thank you so much.
Virendar, thank you so much. It was very interesting listening, you know, not just to your presentation, but from our previous background of Ramco as a company itself and how you are transformed and being agile. Thank you so much. Thanks for taking the time to be here. Before you leave the stage, let me invite Dhananjay to hand over a memento to you. And as Dhananjay is walking in here, we also have donated a small amount of money for the education of the child that you see on the screen.